He's always been.
Oh, he lives.
Well, I was lost in shame, could not get past my way until they called my name. I'm so glad he changed me, conflicts held me down, but Jesus pulled me out. I'm no longer bound. I'm so glad he changed me. See, I'm a new creation in Christ. The old is gone, there's new life. I live by faith by my side. There is a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Yes, it's mine. In Christ, the old is gone, there's new life. I live by faith by my side. There is a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, yes, it's mine, yes, it's mine, Lord. I've met the author of my story, and he's mine, yes, he's mine.
Where you'll see,
'cause I'm crying.
I was thinking this week, and I told somebody earlier this week, you know what? If the devil knew what was going to be accomplished at the cross, if the devil knew what he would have done, the turmoil he would have created, the salvation that he allowed to happen by killing Jesus, he would have never allowed anybody to say a word against Jesus or to lay a hand on him. Matter of fact, if he knew what was going to happen, he would have tried his best to keep that man alive. If he knew what was going to happen, he would have tried his best. He would have gingerly walked beside him and swept the rocks out of the road. But I'm glad my Savior was willing. From the foundations of the earth, he was slain. He was willing to go to the cross for me, to lay down his life, but not only to lay it down, but to pick it back up in victory and in power and rise again for me. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Well, before I bring the message this morning, Dylan and Caleb are going to come and present, make a presentation to you. Song is called Now Behold the Lamb.
Thank you. That in the end of the Sabbath is when they came.
Sabbath would have been from sundown on Friday to sundown on Saturday. They came in the middle, they came early that morning on Sunday morning after Sabbath was over to come. Jesus had had a busy week. Last week we celebrated Jesus riding through the road of Jerusalem, riding through as they worshiped him and they laid their cloaks down at the feet of the donkey. As Jesus came riding through on that donkey, they began to sing hosannas to him. Then on Monday, Jesus would go into the temple. Glorious celebration on Sunday, and then Monday he would go into the temple and clear the place out. He would tell them that they should make it a house of prayer and not a den of robbers. Then on Tuesday he would speak to them at the Mount of Olives. We call it the Olivet Discourse. And he would tell them about the end times and what to expect after he's gone. Many of them didn't realize that he would be gone, but he was trying to teach them about the signs of the time and what to look for. And thank God he did. On Wednesday, he was sitting at a man's house called Simon the Leper, and as he was sitting there, a sinful woman, a prostitute, we know came in by the name of Mary, and came in and began to anoint his feet, anoint his head with oil and his feet, and began to cry and wipe his feet with her tears. They tried to stop her from doing that, but Jesus told them that this will be preached about wherever the gospel is preached. On Thursday, he sits down at a Passover meal. Just 4 days after he was celebrated, he sits down at a Passover meal and begins to drink the cup and says, "This is my blood," and begins to eat the bread and say, "This is my body," telling them that he's about to be crucified. He then would go to the garden and pray, is where he would be arrested and Judas would carry out his final act. And showing them where Jesus would be that night. Throughout the night and the next day, he would be tried. He would be turned over to Pilate. Pilate would try to give him room for escape. But eventually, Jesus would be crucified out of the cries of some of the same people who cried Hosanna 5 days prior. And they would yell, "Crucify him." He would be crucified, and by 3 o'clock he would be dead. A man by the name of Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, who he had talked to at night, where we get our most famous scripture, John 3:16. They would come and get his body and place his body in a tomb. Then Saturday, that's where his body rests. A day that they put aside as a Sabbath. Then after that day, we see these two women coming to the tomb of Jesus. And now it was time for the Lamb of God to rise again. He didn't stop being the Lamb at the cross. He continues to be our Lamb. He's still the Lamb that takes our pain.
Right.
He's still the Lamb that takes all our struggles.
Yeah.
He's still the Lamb that takes all our hurt. He's still the Lamb that takes all our sin.
Yeah.
He's still the Lamb of God.
Yeah.
In Revelation chapter 5, he will still be the Lamb who is worthy to break the seals from the scroll and begin to see the wrath of God poured out on this earth. He's still the Lamb that is able to break every chain that has bound your life. He's still that same Lamb. He's still that same Jesus. He's still that same Savior. After the Sabbath, at the end of the Sabbath, the Scripture tells us, began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see. At the end of the Sabbath, we have seekers. The seekers came to see his body. We know these two to be Mary Magdalene, and in this scripture it tells us the other Mary. Mark tells us that it was Mary, the mother of James and Joseph. Many believe her to be the aunt of Jesus, the sister of Mary, his mother. We don't know much about her, but we know a lot. We know some about Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was a woman who lived a simple life. Mary Magdalene was one who had seven demons in her, but along came Jesus to cast them out. Here is Mary Magdalene at the tomb, and she comes with spices. Many believe her to be the one who just a couple of days prior was the one who poured oil on his head and worshiped at his feet. Many believe that because it says that she was a sinful woman who did that. And we know Mary Magdalene must have been if she had seven demons. But here in this moment, she comes looking for the one who had saved her. She comes looking for the body of the one who had died on a cross. There's no way she could have understood all the implications of that and what that would mean for her. But in this moment, she is sorrowful because he's gone, and she comes to the tomb to anoint the body of Jesus once again with the spices that she had. They came looking for the dead. The Bible says that they see a sepulcher. At the end of the Sabbath, these seekers come to a sepulcher. You know, I see a lot of people, when I'm with my children, I see a lot of people when they see me and they see my kids and they haven't seen us in a few years, they'll say, "Oh my goodness, your kids grew up." Like somehow, and I've done it too, but somehow we expect the kids to be the same age and the same size as they were the last time we saw them. We remember them how they used to be. People seem surprised when they've seen they've grown up. When they came to see Jesus, they expect him to be in the same state as they last saw him when he was dead. When he had died, and they watched him carrying his body to the tomb. They expected him to still be lying in the same place, in the same condition, or possibly even worse by this point. They came looking at the tomb. Can I tell you this morning that there are going to be some people who are going to come back to your tomb to see you, but they're going to be surprised that you're not there anymore. There are going to be some people that come to see you, and you may have seen those people. Some people that see you and say, "Hey man, you look different than the last time I saw you. Hey man, you don't look..." And what they really want to say, "You don't look like the same dead guy I saw before. You don't look like the same guy who was living in sin, who had allowed sin to overtake your body even, and your spirit, and your demeanor. And now you have this joy about you now." They were looking for things to be the same as the last time they saw it, but they come to the tomb and see that something has happened. Romans 8:13 says, "For if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live." Romans 6:5-7, "For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin, for he that is dead is freed from sin. Jesus had to die. Jesus had to die to free us from sin. But thank God the story didn't end there. He's alive. He's alive forevermore. There's not a dead body in the tomb. And yes, we have to die to our sin as well. But thank God that's not the end of the story. He didn't come just so you can leave sin. He didn't come just so you can stop doing the bad things that you've been doing. He didn't come just so you can have a different look on your face. He came so that you can have life and have it more abundantly. He didn't come just so you can sit on a church pew. He didn't come so you can be with a beautiful church family. Thank God for all those things. He didn't come just so you can do work. But he came to give you life. He came so you can feel life again. These dead bodies of ours, living in sin and the death of sin, God is quickening us by his Spirit. The Bible says, behold, there was a great earthquake. If we're living the resurrection life, then the dead's going to come back to life. That's what the resurrection is. But in order to do that, sometimes, I would contend all the time, there has to be a shaking. The power of the resurrection that is in each and every one of us that know Jesus will require you and will require a shaking to go on inside of you. There's a flesh inside of us that doesn't want to change. There's a flesh inside of us that wants us to be dead. But thank God for the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. There's something. There's a spirit that will completely shake things up in our lives. Sometimes shaking things up could be a bad thing. But this is a good thing. Look, some people are hesitant to come to the Lord because they know there's going to be a shaking. They know there's going to be some decisions that need to be made. They know that there's going to be some things that their flesh is battling against. It's easier just to say, okay, I'm just going to be dead, than to say, I want to run after life. And that might mean I have to make some choices in my life that the flesh is battling against. But I got to make some choices in my life. There's some shaking that's going to go on. It's going to feel uncomfortable at first. But some, because some don't like change, your flesh is being shaken. Your desires are being shaken. Your mind is being shaken. Your thought life is being shaken. But sometimes things have to be shaken in order to be torn down. Sometimes the shaking comes to destroy the old and put up the new. Sometimes the shaking has to happen in order for the obstacles to be moved out of your life. Hebrews 12:27 tells us, whose voice then shook the earth, talking about God's voice. But now he hath promised, saying, yet once more, I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifying the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. There's another shaking coming. Amen. God is shaking his church right now, I believe. God is shaking his people. If you're going to live this resurrection life, there's going to be some shaking. But the word of God tells us in Hebrews 12 that he's shaking it to see what's going to remain. He's shaking it to see who's going to fall by the wayside and who's still going to stand. He's shaking it to see who is the real church, who's really going to serve me. And we've seen some fall. We've seen some go by the wayside. And I don't glory in that at all. I wish they all would stand. But God is revealing to the church who is real and who is fake. God is revealing to the church who is real and who is counterfeit. If there's going to be a resurrection life, there's going to be some shaking. Those things that you want to hold on to, if you right and what's wrong. Because you'll find out the dead things will fall off, and the things that will remain for eternity will stay. If you want resurrection life, you allow the shaking to happen in your life. Then it tells us about a stone. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door in verse 2. Let me make one thing clear. For those of you who haven't heard me say this before, the stone was not rolled back so Jesus could come out. The stone was rolled back so we could see he's not there. Amen. Jesus did not leave. Otherwise, they would have seen Jesus walk out as the stone rolled out. They went in and looked and he wasn't there. As the stone rolled away, they saw that he wasn't there anymore. He was already gone. Why? Because that resurrection body must have walked through the tomb. Must have walked through the stone. There's no stone that's going to hold him back. The grave could not hold him. No stone could keep him from leaving the grave. There are things, or there were things in your life that were stones. You were locked in darkness. You could not see the light. The stone was too heavy. And in addition to that, it was sealed. It seemed like your destiny was sealed. It seemed like there was no way you could ever not be the person you used to be. It seemed like there was no hope for change in your life. The perception was that you would stay there forever. But the resurrection life, thank God, does not depend on perception. Because we live by faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Don't let the stones in your life limit your faith. The stone will be moved. You might be in this house today and there might be some things you're battling, and you might feel like you're living in darkness, and you might feel like you can't get out, and you might feel like you're trapped in being who you are for the rest of your life. But I've come with good news for you today. The same Jesus, the same power that made that stone roll back, could be the same power that could roll the stone back in your life as well. It is not sealed. Your destiny is not sealed unless your destiny is in Him. He's the only one that can seal it. The enemy can never seal anything on you. The enemy can never put an obstacle in your way that God cannot remove, and He wants to remove it today. The same Jesus, the same Spirit that rose Jesus from the grave is the same Spirit that's here today to set you free and give you new life. They remember seeing the dead body, but God has breathed new life. God has breathed new life in you, transformed you, and set you free. Romans 6:11 says, "Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord." They saw the stone, and then in verse 3, they describe these shining messengers. Or at least in Matthew, they tell us of one. Other Gospels, they tell us of two. That doesn't mean the Gospels are false. It just means there's different ways to tell the story. But we know there were angels there. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. He was shining like lightning, and his clothes were pure white. Why? Because he had been in the glory of God. This angel that we're seeing, and other angels we see throughout Scripture, some of these angels are just like men. Like they didn't even know they were in the presence of angels until the angel left, and they started sensing the fact there's something different about this guy. But in this passage, it tells us that the angel was shining like lightning. Moses found this out, that when you get in the glory of God, you shine. In Exodus 34:29, when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony, in Moses' hand when he came down from the mount, that Moses wist not that the skin of his face shone while he talked with him. He was shining as he talked with him. This angel had no doubt been in the presence of God and in the glory of God. And what greater glory could there be than to see and witness the resurrection of Jesus Christ? When you have been in the presence of God, people notice. When you're living this resurrection life, people will notice that you've been in the presence of God. They can't help but recognize the power of God that's been in your life. Then it tells us of soldiers. But this is what it tells us of the soldiers. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. As a result of the shaking, the soldiers became like dead men. When people begin to see the presence of God in our lives, if we're really living this resurrected life, if we're really living in the power of God, if we're really getting in the presence of God, when they see us, then something's going to change when they get near this resurrection power. I believe if we would really live in the glory of God, in the presence of God, and we'd really seek after God, we start to see people where they would begin to die to the things of this world. That people around us will become like dead men to this world. And they will die to themselves as well. That's what this world needs. They need a church that's going to live in resurrection power. And you might be here today and you don't know Jesus, but that's what he wants to do in you too. He wants to shake you. He wants to transform you. He wants to change you so that one day you will glow with the glory of God. You might be here today and say, no, not me. Yeah, no, not you. Not within yourself, but by the power of God. It's by the resurrection power of God that's going to happen in your life. If he can do it for some of these, if he can do it for me, he can do it for you. They need to see, the world needs to see men and women who have been resurrected, who have been changed. They need to experience the supernatural power of God. They need to see God's messenger shining with the glory of God. And when they do this, they will shake with the fear of God and die to themselves. We're going to see a change, church, if we'll live in that resurrection power. He didn't just resurrect so we could get together on one Sunday a year and celebrate his resurrection and talk about how he was resurrected. He resurrected from the grave so that we can have that life too. Then these women were greeted with a salutation. He is not here, for he is risen. Come see the place where the Lord lay. And then the angel told them, go quickly and tell his disciples that he's risen from the dead. They get the news now. They finally get it. They get the news that the Savior is risen. He's alive. He's alive. Now go and tell it. Go and tell the world that Jesus is risen. The resurrected life tells others of the resurrection. I heard one man say, get the word out, that the word is out. The word of God has left the tomb. And we must get the word out to people around that this Savior is resurrected. But then I didn't read this before, but I want to read this to you. And I'm closing. And they deepened quickly from the sepulcher, verse 8 through 10, with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, all hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said unto them, be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me. On the way to tell the disciples, they met the Savior once again. They heard the news. They experienced the glory of God. But now they get to see him for themselves. He's now there, and they get to touch him. And there might be some in this house today. You've heard about Jesus. You've heard stories about Jesus. You know who Jesus is. But you've never really met him as your Savior. You've never really held on to him the way that you should have. You've never really worshiped him with your life. His presence, he promised us, would be here if two or more would gather together in his name. His presence is here in this place today. The same Savior that rose again 2,000 years ago is the same Savior whose presence is in this place today. Who wants to transform you today. Who wants you to feel the same resurrection power that he felt when his body was laid in that tomb. So why is it important that he lives? Because now we can be sure that he is the Son of God. Otherwise, he could have been just a guy who said a lot of fancy things, promised a lot of fancy things, and died as a martyr for a cause. But now, because he's resurrected, we know for sure everything he said is true. He is the Son of God. And he lives forevermore. Without the power, there's another reason. Without the power to rise again, he can't be our Savior. If he doesn't have power to raise himself up, he doesn't have power to raise us up again. And if he is still dead, then his Spirit cannot be alive in us. But he's alive. He's alive today. And his Spirit is alive in us. His Spirit dwells in us, Romans 8, 9, but ye are not in flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit, he is none of his. He tells us that the Spirit of God dwells in us, the Spirit of Christ, if we know him. The resurrection power of the Spirit of God lives in us and works through us. You can make it. Somebody needs to hear that word today. You can make it. Because he's still alive. You can make it. How do I know? Because Romans 8, 11 tells us, but if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. You can make it. If his Spirit can raise Jesus from the dead, and his Spirit can give you the power to overcome anything in your life, there's no stone, there's no seal, there's nothing, there's no soldier, there's nothing that the enemy could throw at you that could hinder your walk with God, because we have the Spirit of God living in and through us if we know Jesus. But if you don't know him, you're probably still living in a dark tomb. If you don't know him, you probably have stones in the way. And you wish you could get out. But there's no way out. Except you just heard about the only way. He's the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through him. And this same Jesus comes with the same power today to raise you up and change your life forever. The truth is, friend, you deserve death. You were born in sin. The wages of sin is death. I deserve death. But the Scripture tells us the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. You deserve to be on the cross of him, but he died in your place so that you could live so that he could take away your sins, so that you wouldn't have to experience that punishment. That was his gift to you. But a gift is no good unless you receive it. And because that Jesus did that for you, and you can receive that gift today, you're not just receiving your sins going away, but you're receiving new life because he rose again so that you can have new life. This isn't a fairy tale. He's coming back one day to get his church.
Amen.
Hallelujah. No matter how bad things look today, no matter how much shaking is going on today, one day he's coming back to get his church, and we're going to live and reign for him forever, with him forever. And the question is, are you going to be part of that church? Are you going to experience the resurrection power of Jesus Christ? With every head bowed and every eye closed, I feel led to do that this way this morning. If you're here today, this isn't a church game. Let me just say that. This isn't a church game. This is something we just do because this is what you're supposed to do in church. This is stuff we do because we don't want to see you die and go to hell. But we want to see you live eternally in heaven with us. We believe in a God that can change you. If you're here today and you say, look, I don't know Jesus, but I want to receive him today. I want to experience this resurrection power you're talking about. And I don't know how I'm going to get out of where I'm at except for him and how he's going to help me get out of it. But wherever I'm at right now, I need Jesus to get me out of my mess. I need Jesus to come and get me out of the sin that I've been living in. I need that resurrection power today. If that's you and you say, hey, I need Jesus to change me today. If that's you and you say, I want to receive him today. Repent of the things I've done and chase after him the rest of my life. If that's you, if you say that's you today, would you just raise your hand and say, I want to receive Jesus today.